Welcome to the November Hyperledger Financial Markets Mortgage Subgroup meeting. I'm getting better at saying that. Before we get started, I'd like to express our appreciation to the Financial Markets Special Industry Group and the Hyperledger Foundation for their support. They're the guys that really make this possible. So thank you to them. And why don't we go ahead and just dive right into just the antitrust policy. We always start off with the same things. Please note that this meeting is being recorded under the umbrella of the Hyperledger Foundation. So we ask that everyone abide by the antitrust policy and the code of conduct. Antitrust policy states that we avoid discussions of company-specific product and pricing, don't make negative remarks about other companies or products. And the code of conduct means that we treat each other with respect, never discriminate, communicate constructively. We fully support Hyperledger's policy of openness, equity, and inclusion. And for new participants, please introduce yourself in the chat if you'd like. And if there's any areas of specific interest, please let us know.
And, you know, Marvin, to add to that really quick, you bring up a really good point. We do record this session on a monthly basis. It is posted out on YouTube on the Hyperledger site. So if you're interested in this session or previous sessions or future sessions, feel free to take a look at the Hyperledger YouTube site.
Yep. Thanks, James. So our agenda, we're making a slight change in today's agenda. We've moved the speaker portion up to accommodate some scheduling conflicts, but as always, please feel free to ask questions. This is an open forum and we all benefit from questions, comments, and interactions. So with that, I would like to introduce Rick Grant. He's the president of RGA Publications, a communication consultancy. Rick was also recently appointed the chair of Blackfin's innovation-focused think tank, the Innovation Leadership Cohort. Rick has also been producing a series of podcasts titled Would You Consider? And that's what he's going to be discussing with us today, that's focused on the industry, on the mortgage industry. So Rick, take it away.
Thank you, Marvin. Guys, thanks for having me. Thank you also for adjusting your schedule. I have a conflict that made that difficult, and you guys made it easy, so thank you very much. So today, and I guess you've got my slides, Marvin, on your side?
Yes, I do.
Okay, not that they're all that necessary, but what I want to talk to you about today is first and foremost what Mark D'Angelo and I are doing. And Mark is a well-known author and speaker. He writes mostly for MBA Mortgage Newslink right now. And he came to me earlier this summer, I said, we should do a podcast. And I've been doing podcasting off and on since 2005. And I said, that's a great idea. And today I want to tell you what we're doing, but also why. And then in the last few minutes, talk to you about why you should all be doing more podcasting, more podcast appearances, and three keys to looking and sounding really good when you do that. And it's not technical stuff, right? So that's the trick there. All right. So, and I apologize. Got a chest cold that I'm getting over now. All right, so let's see. Did I have slides? I don't see slides.
Apologies, Rick. I am just bringing up the slides.
Oh, that's right fine. Now. That's fine. Okay. When it comes up, we're going to talk about the growth in podcasting. Almost everyone in the country has downloaded at least one episode of one podcast, and we've seen massive growth over the last 5-6 years. Although that the rate of that growth is slowing because we're seeing more people on the internet over the last few years as well. But still, it's very significant. If you look at Spotify, they'll tell you they have about 3.6 million podcasts out there. That's podcast shows. Apple will tell you that they've indexed 63 million podcast episodes. And increasingly, those episodes are business-to-business podcasts. And why? Well, it adds so much when they can hear you and see you speak about what they do. If I had just written a little thing for Marvin to read that says, oh, Rick thinks podcast is important, you might have listened to it. It might have had some impact on you, but not really anything significant. But if I come to you and I show you this slide, which is the next slide, Marvin, thank you for getting that up. I show you the next slide and the growth, and you can see graphically how it's growing and how it's changing, well, that's likely to have a better impact on you. And it doesn't have to be in the early days when I started in 2005, it was all about audio podcasting. And that's really great on the B2B side because busy executives can just download it to their phone, play it through their car, punch in the Spotify button on their dash, and they can hear your podcast while they're driving. They can consume that information without really even trying to. But increasingly, we're seeing video as well as podcasting. The podcast I'm doing with Mark is video. And we'll just get on Zoom and we'll talk and we'll have a guest come on and they'll tell us what they think we should be talking about now, right? So, and that's the whole point of it is, would you consider? So we'll get a guest on for about 5 minutes and in a pre-recorded segment, and we'll say, what's really important right now? And they'll tell us, it'll usually take about 20 minutes for them to kind of really explain what it is. And then we'll edit that down to 5 minutes. We'll put it in the podcast and we'll talk about it. And then that's kind of the entry level. We can do more things with the podcast as we go forward. But that's an easy way for anyone in the industry who knows what leaders should be talking about now to get on that podcast and talk about it. But it's one of millions of shows, right? Millions of shows out there that are allowing leaders to talk about what's important. So if you look at the next slide, you'll see a quote from someone writing in Forbes about the rise in business podcasting. And she says, the industry spending binge is a solid indicator of how large podcasts are poised to become global. Another factor is the large selection of genres available. There's something for everyone, blah, blah, blah. Business podcasts are getting increasingly popular. And I'll tell you why. It's not because business people want to sit and listen to a Joe Rogan style show for 2 hours. I don't know any of us who have time for that, even though I love the guy. What we do have time for is 5 to 15 minutes during the due diligence phase where we say, yeah, I keep hearing about this person, but I don't know. I haven't met them. Do I really want to work with them? Let's take a look. They pull up the podcast, they listen to them, and they hear something that makes them say, all right, okay, give them a call. Let's start this conversation. And for that, they're very popular. And that may explain why of the millions of podcasts that are out there in the world right now, about half of them are only downloaded, according to Apple, 26 times. So only about 26 people will listen to more than half of the podcast episodes that are out there. But if those are 26 business leaders that you want to do business with, what's that do to your business, right? So that's why we're seeing so many, and they just don't care that they don't have 1,000 or 10,000 listeners, because on the B2B side, we just want to connect with the person we want to do business with. So we'll record this podcast, we'll put it on our website, and we'll wait for them to show up, right? All right. So the next slide is just about our show, Mark and I. It's super simple. We pre-record with the guests, so there's no way you can make a mistake. You get on, you visit with us for a little while about something that you think is really important, and we try to focus you on one topic of conversation. Imagine that you were in a conference, you're out in the hallway, you see somebody that you know, you have just a few minutes to talk to them. What are you going to talk about? That's the point of the show. So would you consider talking about this or this? And we started planning it for one of the big, well, the fall conference season, really, because we knew all these conversations were going to be going on. And we wanted to kind of get a feel for where they would be. And what we found was that the business leaders were so busy getting their stories together that they didn't have time to podcast it ahead of the show. But now they're coming to us to talk about what they did talk about at the show and why everyone should consider talking about that, right? So if you look at the next slide, boiled down basically what we're looking for, we're looking for experts who can explain in about 5 minutes a new trend or some critical consideration, why it's important that we discuss it now, the impact of not dealing with this now, which will be negative, of course, and one thought that will really get people thinking about it. What's that catalyst idea that we need to discuss? There is no charge for this, right? Now, this 5 minutes will be about, well, probably 20 to 30 minutes of conversation, but we'll edit it down to that best 5 minutes, right? So now, say I've got you thinking about it now, and you're thinking, well, I'm in this group. I know a lot of things we should be talking about right now as well. I know you do. So how can you do the best job of that? So let's go to the next slide. Got to keep muting while I cough. So when I started podcasting was in 2005, and I really started because I had left my job at the publication and I didn't know about PR. I was just a writer and I wasn't willing to charge people to do PR until I learned it, and I didn't really want to learn it. So I started a PR business or a podcasting business, and it went great. And we specialized in 5-minute, you know, executive insight podcasts like this. I ended up selling that to a PR firm that then, as part of that deal, trained me to be a PR guy, which is why I own a PR firm today. But I still don't like that business, but that's a whole other story. So podcasting I've been doing since about 2005, and I love it. And what I've learned is that for an executive to come across really well on a podcast, and really, and the way you can tell is afterwards they like it. And they say, Rick, that was great experience. I really like that. And that's hard to get people to say, because nobody likes the way they look on camera and nobody likes the way they sound on tape. But if you can get them to say, that was great, you know you're doing it right. Well, there's three keys to that. So we'll talk about those really quickly. The next slide is the first one. And that is, you have to sound like a real human, right? That'd be real. That sounds easy because we're all real humans, but in fact, it's not easy for business executives because they have marketing teams. And the marketing team has done a tremendous amount of work getting all their talking points together, keeping them on brand. And so typically when I talk to a business executive and I ask them an important question, the first time they're going to give me straight up marketing speak. They're going to say, Rick, according to our official publication and all of our material, this is what we do and why. And it's really boring and nobody likes that. So we'll talk about more things for a while, and then we'll come back to it. The second time I ask them that question a little bit differently, they'll do the same thing, but they'll start to sound more human. I said, well, no, Rick, the marketing people have told me that this is what we do and this is why we do it. The third time I get to it, they go, Rick, look, this is what we do. This is what we're passionate about, and this is how it works, and this is great. And I say, thank you. That's what I was looking for. Sound like a real human. Don't sound like a robot that's come out of the marketing department. I know that's tough because you pay those marketing people good money to get all that stuff together. But if you come across that way on audio and video, nobody's going to listen to you. All right. So it's hard, but it's not impossible. Well, what's the second key? That's the next slide. Oh, man. I'm sorry you're having to put up with my voice today. Demonstrate that you know your stuff, right? Now, the best way to do this is to feed your podcaster questions. I want you to ask me about this. I want you to ask me about this and this, because that's the stuff you do every day. You know it like the back of your hand. And when people hear you talk about stuff that you really know, because you're really doing it right now, they start to get this feeling of trust with you. They start to think, okay, all right, this person is a real person, first of all, and they seem to really know what they're talking about. That's good. But they're not going to decide to do business with you unless you have the third key. So let's go to the next slide. And the third key is, sometime during the podcast, you have to demonstrate that you are passionate about helping people solve their problem. Now, I've talked to, thousands of business executives in my career, fantastic people, all. And they're all passionate about what they do. But the mistake they often make is that they're passionate about what they do, not always what their customer needs, right? So this is really important for this group, right? You guys have an amazing, theoretically incredible, impactful technology that could change everything. But if we just talk about that and not talk about the problems that we solve with it, we're not going to get them. We're not going to get their attention. They're not going to make that final click on that combination lock that says, this is a real person. They know their stuff and they get my problem. And they're talking about helping me solve it. And they're sounding like that's what they want to do. And it's not just, well, we have to make certain profitability by the end of the quarter and we have to make sure that all these are. No, it's about, we get what you're struggling with. We get it. We've lived it. We've watched you live it. We've lived it together. We're peers. And now we have a technology that can change all that. But I'm not going to tell you everything it can do because, God, we'd be here for days. I'm going to talk about your problem and show you why that's what I'm passionate about helping you solve. All right. So if you can do those three things in any podcast appearance, you are going to come out looking and sounding great. Fantastic. Don't get caught up with the typical, well, have the makeup. Is my eye shiny? Is my face shiny? Can you hear me well? Is this fine? None of that matters, right? On the B2B side. All that matters on the B2B side is, do I trust? And like right now, Marvin, I'm looking directly at you on my screen. Do I trust this person? Because if I don't, the conversation stops right there. It never goes beyond that. But if I do, if I understand, and how does that trust build? One, he's a real person. He's not just selling me something somebody told him to sell me. Two, he really understands what he's talking about. And three, he gets where I'm at. He gets my problem and he seems passionate to help me solve it. Yes, yes, Marvin, sit down with me. We got to figure this out. That's how it works. So will Mark and I be able to do that on our podcast? No, we won't be able to take you all the way to the end. But what we can do is let the industry know that you're a real person. You know what you're talking about and you see the potential to solve a problem, but we have to have this discussion first. We have to talk about this important thing, right? So I know that's a little over the top. Rick, aren't you just talking about some podcast recording? Yes, yes, I am. But it can be one of the most powerful tools that you have in your arsenal. It can start the conversations that will get you to the people who can make decisions that can advance what you're working on. It can take you beyond the theoretical phase of, wow, look what we could do, to, wow, we're going to work together to solve this problem, right? That gap, you can solve it with something like this. And it could start on our podcast. And all you got to do, if you go to the next slide, I think, is it the next slide? Is our contact information? Yeah, that's it. Just email me, call Marvin. Marvin's got my contact information. Get to us, we'll schedule something, we'll have the conversation, it'll all be pre-recorded. In the old days, excuse me, when I started, I used to cut it all up and then send it back and get approval, and it was a long process, and they always approved it because we're from this industry, we're from financial services, and we've been writing about it forever and a day, so we're not going to make you look stupid. We want to find out what's the most impactful part of your message. And we will find it in that 20 or 30 minute call, condense it down to 4 to 5 minutes, put it in our podcast, and then Mark and I will talk about it, bat it back and forth. And your company may say, ooh, we want to be a bigger part of that conversation. And then we can talk about sponsorship down the road where you could actually get on there with us and really dig into it. But for this first phase, what we're doing is just trying to seed the industry with the conversations that matter, the things they should be talking about. And by industry, I mean basically all of the industries that we touch, not just mortgage, not just banking, not just insurance or any of those, but anyone who can benefit from the changes that smart technologists are trying to bring to the market. That's it. Thank you for listening. I got the chat open. If there's any questions or any concerns or things you wondered about, there are all kinds of podcasts going on B2B in your industry. Just do a quick search, go to Apple Podcasts, do a search, find out who they are, send them a note. They're always looking for guests, always. Figure out what you want to say, make sure you got the three keys down and get out there and do it. Do it. Keep having those conversations and it'll serve you well.
That's awesome, Mark. The reason, or excuse me, Rick, I have Mark D'Angelo in my head. That's awesome, Rick. The reason I wanted to have you on here is because there's so much chaos within the mortgage industry right now. This is a fantastic tool for people in the mortgage industry to get their ideas out there, to use your podcast channel to reach a broader audience. For example, just within the Hyperledger meetings that we have, there are usually about a couple dozen people that attend the actual meetings, but then download it. You're talking about 300-400 people download our Hyperledger meetings. So your podcasts make this information extremely digestible and easier for people to get their ideas across and start the conversation. I also wanted to mention the point that really stuck out is to be human. One of the key things I always try to do every day, I Rizdahl on NPR. That guy, I've never met him, but he's like one of my best friends because he's human. I listen to him every day. I trust him. your podcast would allow someone to develop that type of relationship with their customers, or at least get out there. So that was fantastic. Rick, thank you.
Rick, thank you very much for, you know, taking the time with us today. And Mark's a great individual. He and I were both on a panel a couple days ago at the IEEE. And he's been on our, you know, talks here as well. So we appreciate it greatly. You know, for some of our people that are listening in or watching this later, can you maybe give us some highlights of some of those podcasts relevant to the, you know, blockchain industry, the mortgage industry that you and Mark have talked about in the past?
Yeah. So if you know Mark D'Angelo, and if you've read any of his stuff online or any of his four or five books, you know that guy takes a, it's not a 30,000 foot. I think he's in orbit and he's looking down because he sees so much more than we do. My constant challenge is focusing on one problem, right? And I rarely get it done. But we've talked about everything on the show from data meshes to specific implementations of blockchain in different parts of the mortgage business to recruiting problems that the industry's having going forward. All important conversations, and nothing's off the table with us. But again, we're just one of probably, there's probably 10 or 20 in any industry you want to pick that would be good for any member of your group to go on and talk about and seed some good information in there.
Okay. So, Rick, the best way for people to be a part of this process is to reach out to you and then bounce their ideas off of you, and then you can help them get an introductory podcast out.
Absolutely. And I'm not the judge of their ideas. All I want to know is, do they know their stuff, and can they condense it to something that I can fit into 5 minutes? Some of the conversations that we have to have, especially with new technologies as groundbreaking as what you guys are working on, is that some of those conversations are massive and big, but I want to focus in on what are those key ideas? What are those catalysts that can get that conversation going so they can take it there? They take it off the podcast into the real world and solve those problems. So yes, all they've got to do is email me or contact me anyway. I'm on LinkedIn, I'm all around the place, and say, Rick, I want to be on the show. We'll schedule a time, have a Zoom meeting, talk for 20 minutes. And that's it. I'll cut it down to 5 minutes. I'll show it to Mark. We'll get on the phone probably on a Saturday. We usually do it. And we'll kick it out. We try to keep our shows to about 30 minutes. But again, I'm working with Mark, so that's difficult. Because if he tells me everything he knows, I know, Jim, you're laughing. But so it's a lot of fun.
Being Mark on the other end here.
Oh, my God, Mark, you stopped me. So now I'm under the bus. Oh, my God. Mark, you know I love you. You know I love you. It's just keeping it to 20 minutes in a conversation with Mark D'Angelo is a Herculean task. And I look forward to it every time we schedule a podcast.
It's something like herding cats.
And Mark, since you're here, and I'm so glad you're here, you did a great job on the IEEE panel at the beginning of the week. So thank you very much. You and James were fantastic panelists, and we'll talk about that later on this call. But you guys did a great job. So you're extremely knowledgeable and always welcome to hear your input on any topic.
Gosh, now I'm blushing if you could see me. Thank you.
Guys, I do have to leave and prepare for something at the bottom of the hour, but I want to really thank you so much for letting me talk to your group about this. And I hope they take advantage of it because we really want to see you guys advance what you're working on.
Yeah, we appreciate it greatly, Rick. As I said, in some of the articles I'm going to talk about, we're going to talk about two other podcasts that are out there as well, doing examples of exactly what you're talking about here.
Yeah, and we definitely want to do a podcast, Rick, so consider us waiting in line.
Excellent. Excellent. I will look forward to it. Guys, have a great rest of your meeting.
You too.
Take care, Rick.
Okay, let me see if I can go back to sharing my screen. Okay, so hopefully you guys see the blockchain presentation again. I'm not gonna spend any time on this. We always go through this slide just to talk about the blockchain journey and what we're all trying to do. So let me go ahead and skip to the next section. What I wanted to talk about in this section was about a month or so ago, there was the Hyperledger Global Forum in Dublin, Ireland. There were a series of presentations, I think about 94 of them. I've identified a couple that I think are really interesting for this specific audience, and I wanted to share that information with you. The first presentation is a discussion of a real estate property management application using tokens and DeFi, as you can see on the screen. Mohan Venkataraman, the CTO of Chainyard, he was one of the speakers at the IEEE as well. He does an excellent job of walking through the application that his company built. It's for a Kansas rental property management company. And this application allowed accredited investors fractional ownership through tokenization in rental properties. So there's the link at the bottom of the screen. And I wanted to share just some additional information on this application. The use case for this application was their client, as I said, rental property company, wanted to use tokenization and blockchain to attract small investors. They wanted to increase liquidity and maximize earnings for investors. So it's really similar to the secondary market aspect of mortgages. I won't go over the key requirements. They're listed on the slide, but the ones that I want to point out are the ability to buy and sell a stake with minimum latency, and that's the benefit of tokenization, and compliance with existing laws and regulations. So it's, I think, a really fantastic tool, and the link is at the bottom of the screen. I highly encourage you guys to take a look at it. And just again, really quickly on some of the other information, some of the key steps in the workflow just starts at the top of the screen. The company creates a holding entity tokens, and then they create an LLC for each property and issue an NFT for each new property. So that's how they tokenize a property, and then they collect rents and process dividends. So that's taking place here on the right-hand side. Now the LLC can sell tokens to investors through what they call liquidity pools. Investors can buy the tokens and add to the liquidity pool. And then the investors, the owners of the tokens, receive the dividends, and then they have the liquidity to swap and sell their tokens. So that's just a gross simplification of what's taking place on this slide. But again, I highly encourage you, take a look at the presentation. I think it's well worth your time. The other presentation I wanted to walk you through, and this is kind of, I think this is our tokenization theme, was a presentation by Michael Klein from Accenture. Token economies moving beyond NFTs. It's not about crypto. And I think we all, given the state of Bitcoin and the crypto market, we all want to stay away from crypto for a bit. It's not about crypto, NFTs, and Bored Ape JPEGs. It's about building digital marketplaces. So this is the only slide I'm going to walk you through. It just, as I mentioned in the earlier presentation, there are a lot of similarities between the secondary market aspect of mortgages and the secondary market aspects of tokens. So you can see here that one of the key things Mike stresses in his presentation is tokenizations allow secondary markets to resell and swap those tokens, unlocking their value lifecycle. So it's not just about the very first sale, but about the sale, the nth number of sales that take place in the secondary market. So a really good presentation, And what he really starts to talk about, and I think this has kind of been underlying everything we've been doing in this sub-ledger group, in this mortgage subgroup, is it's all about an ecosystem, a mortgage blockchain ecosystem. So I wanted to get that thought into everyone's head, and this is really starts to talk about it. So I'm not going to go over these additional slides. We always keep them in our presentation, the sitemap, how to create an LFID. So this is for people that are new to the group and want to take advantage of the information that we have out there. With that, I'm going to turn it over to James Hendrick, and he's going to give you guys an update on the state of mortgage in the global mortgage industry.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Marvin. Let's go ahead and move into the first slide. So, you know, following kind of with today's theme, we do have a couple of podcasts that we're going to talk about. You know, looking at the global activity again, here's kind of a refresh of the various articles that we have talked about throughout the sessions this calendar year, as well as in last year as well. Let's go ahead and jump to the next slide, Marvin. So, you know, starting out with 8 crypto loan companies that are using blockchain for lending, this article comes out of Built-In. So while most of the companies that are talked about in this article are US-based, I included it in the global section because a lot of these are spanning across multiple countries. The article starts out with, you know, how does a crypto blockchain mortgage work? Business loans, bonds, kind of giving a general overview. And then it discusses the risks that are associated with the crypto-backed loans, particularly in today's market, you know, as we see the impact of market fluctuations that are going on, and how does that impact not only the borrower, but the collateral value as well. We did discuss actually some of this in last month's presentation. Some of the companies that they talk about in this article, SALT, where borrowers can lock into cash loans from 12 to 60 months with an APR as low as 0.52%. They're available in almost every U.S. states, and SALT is starting to expand out to New Zealand, Brazil, the UK, and Switzerland. Liquid mortgage is talked about in the article, where borrowers have a single blockchain platform that helps them track and manage payments and protects their data utilizing blockchain, you know, natural encryption. Lenders have smart contract abilities and real-time transaction data that they're able to work with. And then, you know, a few of the other companies they talk about in this article, and we've talked about them before, WeTrust, Figure, Unchained Capital. So again, great article to take a look at and seeing what's going on in the global platform. One of the first podcasts I wanted to bring up was from Bitcoin Amsterdam. So Connor Sefton does the Coin Market Recap podcast. He had on in the month of October Tristan Marino and Aaron Nevin from Moon Mortgage. They actually started up Moon Mortgage because they were independent contractors and they were having issues going through the traditional method of obtaining a mortgage and providing you know, validation of their income and assets. They talk in the podcast, it's a great discussion on how to blend liquid and stable assets and how to build out a secondary market for crypto mortgages. Volatility in the crypto market, again, is another topic. We're seeing that going on and how that has an impact on crypto-backed mortgages. They are right now currently in designated zip codes. They're really projected on areas that they think the market's going to stay stable for the next 5 years in the US, but they are also expanding across Europe. And as you know, they talk about these mortgages from the borrower's perspective, it looks and feels like a, you know, conventional mortgage that you're going through. So by the time you're into servicing, you know, the borrower's making payments, they're paying their insurance and taxes, pretty much follows the normal life cycle. They're really kind of targeted for these products at, you know, higher end clients that are trying to utilize this for tax shelters on their crypto sales and benefiting from that exposure to the additional asset class that are made available for them. It also, you know, through these programs, it does provide more liquidity in mortgage space and additional options for the borrowers when they're looking at mortgage lending options. So taking a look over in the US space. Thank you, Marvin. We can go ahead and move right past the other side. You know, this first article that I've got on here, it's coming out of CoinDesk. It is also about Moon Mortgage as well, but it focuses more of, hey, what are they actually doing in the US? So, you know, Moon Mortgage has a crypto lending platform, and they've raised $3.5 million in their first seed round. The funds are going to be used to finance Moon Mortgage's lending product, which is called Crypto Mortgage. And Crypto Mortgage can provide up to 100% financing for investment properties. They are launching soon for home buyers in Texas, Florida, and Colorado. But again, as we mentioned, they're starting to spread out across more areas in the U.S. Moon Mortgage's crypto's assets are stored with crypto custodial firm Anchorage Digital, which is a U.S. federally chartered crypto bank. Anchorage Digital Bank is the first crypto native bank to receive a charter from the U.S. Office of the Comptroller of the Currency. So again, some very great information, but it focused more on Moon Mortgage and what they're doing here in the U.S. And then the second podcast that we have up, Blockchain and Mortgage Lending, Tony Garantano, the founder of Progress in Lending, presents the Lending Buzz podcast. He interviews Soren Sarker, the founder and CEO of Nexfell, and they discuss the use of blockchain in mortgage lending. It's a fascinating discussion. They're discussing why lenders are ready now for blockchain mortgages. And some of the topics that they talk about is because, you know, blockchain is designed for distributed info. It removes those intermediaries that are no longer required. The elimination of monetizing data by these intermediaries. And in examples of like a servicing loan transfer, I thought he took a very interesting perspective. He talks really about how the data essentially belongs to the end borrower and not to the company. It's transactional data. And in the example of a servicing loan transfer, that transfer process requires the auditing of the data, the re-auditing data, the repeated review of records, both physical documents and data as a loan is being transferred. And these costs are embedded in the industry and are ultimately passed on to the borrowers for the cost of their loan at the time of funding. And so the podcast really is going into the depths of how moving into Web3 technologies, into blockchain, not only can save money for the lenders by streamlining the process, but it can also reduce the overall cost to the borrowers because those costs are ultimately passed along. Also in the podcast, they talk about the current state of the technology in the mortgage industry, really kind of focused on how the industry players need to come together to accept the technology into the ecosystem. So this is going to involve players across the board, MBA, GSEs, lenders, investors, title companies, you pretty much name it to come together, whether they're coming together through consortiums or, you know, they're coming together and starting to team. We talked, you know, Mark and I were on a panel for the IEEE this week. We were actually talking about very similar concepts in that panel as well. If you get the opportunity to take a look at that, I recommend you go out and take a look at that video as well. Marvin, our last slide. So as usual, here's a copy of the overall wiki for the mortgage industry subgroup. Again, these articles and previous ones are all accessible from here, as well as we talked earlier, and you can find in the chat the links that are posted for where the YouTube videos are stored. We actually do store a copy of the videos up on the Hyperledger site as well. Thank you guys very much. And that's our presentation for today. I'm gonna pass it back over to Marvin.
Hey, thank you, James. As always, we kind of end with the future agenda topics. I wanted to let people know we're probably going to be taking December off due to the holiday, but we will pick these back up again in January. But in the interim, if there are any topics that you'd be interested in or any questions or comments you think we need to discuss, just please email those to us and we can include it in the next round of presentations. So with that, I wanted to say thank you to everyone. Here's our contact information that's included on this slide. If there are topics or questions that you guys have, please feel free to reach out to anyone on here. Please take a look at the presentations that we reference or the podcast that James was talking about. And as we get access to the IEEE information that James mentioned, we'll send that out to the group as well. And with that, have a good day, everyone. Thank you very much.